All right, good afternoon, everyone. We're seeing lots of people get dialed in. I see Nikki Ellis from Las Vegas. I see someone is joining us from the bourbon capital of the world. Welcome, Austin, Texas. We're so happy that all of you could be here this afternoon. I just wanted to go over a few quick housekeeping things before I hand things over to Deborah Grassman. I know that she has been a dear colleague of NHPCO and a close personal friend of myself. So we continue to be grateful that she is providing us with resources for our We Honor Veterans partners. Again, the recording will be posted following the webinar on the We Honor Veterans website and then on the Opus Peace website as well. Just for clarity, these slides will not be available, so we're encouraging folks to take their own notes. And again, the recordings will be available just in case you miss anything. So without further ado, just a quick introduction. I know many of you are very familiar with her work. Deborah Grassman is a hospice nurse practitioner, and her career at the VA spanned 3 decades. And during that time, she took care of more than 10,000 dying veterans. She is the founder of Opus Peace, which is a nonprofit that provides educational programs, as well as self-help tools that address soul injuries, a wound to our sense of self. So again, without further ado, I'd like to hand it over to Deborah.
Wow. Well, thank you so much, Catherine, for providing this offering today about veterans and how to best serve them. And I'm really thankful that NHPCO recognizes the unique needs of veterans and the special skill set that clinicians need to take care of them. So with Veterans Day just 2 days away, my hope is that after the presentation today, you will be able to bring that skill set to them. So the reason I chose to share my mistakes with you today is that after the last webinar that I did with you in May on assumptions about veterans, I realized that I sounded sort of arrogant and I was fearful that I had given you the wrong impression that I'm this skilled clinician who does all these things naturally. But the truth is, almost all of the complexities of my skill set that I share with you came from the mistakes I made. And the mistakes taught me about the nuances of application when I was applying what I thought I knew. So that's what I hope to share with you today. So mistake number one was a misconception of what my role was as a nurse serving veterans. If you look at the opening chapter of my book, you'll see what I mean. Here's what I wrote about my self-image as a nurse. I was intent on rescuing the world from suffering, not realizing that my idealistic mission was like saving fish from drowning. It would take years of listening to patients before I realized they weren't drowning, and what they really needed was for me to learn how to swim. The problem was, I thought I already knew how. And the title of the chapter is Rescuing the World from Suffering. So you can see how early in my career, I was idealistic and I viewed my role as wanting to fix veterans. And now there's nothing wrong with being idealistic. In fact, I would contend that I'm still idealistic. And that idealism is important if you want to be of service to others. But helping, fixing, and serving represent 3 different ways of seeing life. And Rachel Naomi Riemann says that it's a matter of perspective. She says that when you help, you see life as weak. When you fix, you see life as broken. But when you serve, you see life as whole. She says that fixing and helping may be the work of the ego and service the work of the soul. So certainly when I was a new nurse, my view was that veterans were broken and I'm here to help fix them. As my practice matured, however, I started to expand my perspective and I realized that in certain situations or with certain people, I tended to help. In others, I tended to fix. And still others, I moved into serving. And as Riemann defines service, when I began to serve rather than help or fix, then I started dwelling more from my soul, from my authentic self, rather than my ego. Now, many of you were at the webinar I did last year in which Larry Bird spoke about his experience as a veteran and then his experience working with homeless veterans at the VA in Wisconsin. And I love how he concluded his message. This is what he said. He said, "Now I am able to sit comfortably with the veteran population. I can be the safe space where I witness them find their own truth. Veterans don't need to be fixed. They need hope. We all need hope." I think Larry pretty much sums up the role. We are called to bear witness. And when we do that, we provide hope. So how we see our role, how we see our mission forms the basis for our relationship with the population that we serve and how we fit into that healthcare paradigm. Now for myself, my original need to fix and rescue meant that I could be the hero that fulfilled my grandiose self-image. I saw my role as being a peacemaker and that fulfilled my desire to avoid conflict. My goal was to put a smile on people's face. You know, I worked on a medical oncology unit and I designed teaching programs to help patients stay positive. I used videotapes and books, and they had themes like, "You can do it, hang in there, keep fighting, think positively, chemo is your friend, focus on the 50% who survived this disease." You know, I made posters for the unit with similar themes, and the messages were essentially, what you're going through is not as bad as it seems. There's always hope for recovery. Maintain a good attitude and do these things and you can control what's happening to you. What I didn't realize is that while some of these efforts did help veterans deal with their illness, many of these kinds of strategies only encouraged their grin and bear it stoic attitudes so that their suffering ended up being silent. Now, in the literature, the need to deny negativity by putting a positive spin on everything is called pronoia. In other words, the opposite of paranoia, which puts a negative spin on things. So while paranoids believe that the world is secretly conspiring to make everything bad against them, pronoiacs believe that the world is secretly conspiring in their favor to make everything good. Their fear of negativity subtly conveys a belief that they can't trust themselves to be able to handle negative realities. So early on, I definitely was a pronoia. So lack of self-awareness caused me to make many of my early mistakes. And I had to unlearn some of my misconceptions. And once I did that, I realized a few things about myself. I realized I was uncomfortable with so-called negative feelings like anger, fear, and sadness. And yet those feelings often accompany the diagnosis and treatment of cancer. And because my goal was to fix and make people smile, I felt helpless, inadequate, and ineffective in responding to patients or families that were facing these difficulties. And rather than experience my feelings, I tried to control them by avoiding the upsetting aspects of the illness. So this growth in awareness led to a change in strategy. I shifted from avoiding ugly feelings to learning how to validate the suffering that these feelings caused. So let me tell you about the patient who benefited from my change in how I perceived my role and my mission. One day I was on the hospice unit and I overheard the nurses complaining about a patient who was on the call light all the time because he wanted them to take him out to smoke and they couldn't get him out to smoke as much as he wanted. Well, since I eat my lunch outside, I offered to take the patient with me. So I said to the staff, you know, it'll at least get him off your backs for a little while. Well, so that day I gathered up this disheveled patient with severe emphysema. I said to him, you know, would you like to come out and enjoy the sunshine and a cigarette while I eat my lunch? And he said, yes, ma'am. So I pushed him outdoors. I parked his wheelchair at the edge of the picnic table and I turned off his oxygen. And I tried to hide my annoyance that people with respiratory disease should stop smoking. And then while I ate my lunch, he remained silent. Taking, you know, long drags on a cigarette, looking off into the distance. Occasionally, I'd ask him how he was doing, and he would nod in contentment. And then when lunch was over, that's when he spoke to me really for the first time. And this is what he said to me. He said, I just want to know one thing. What's a woman like you doing eating lunch with a grumpy old man like me? I sort of laughed at his question and I said, oh, I don't know. I sort of like grumpy old men like you. And at this point, I'm now pushing his wheelchair into the hospital and I put one hand on the back of his neck and shoulder and I started massaging his neck as we were going indoors. And he said, oh, thank you, with this big sigh. And you know, I wasn't sure if he was grateful for the massage or for taking him outside to smoke or what. So I asked him what he was thanking me for, but I was really unprepared for his answer. He said, I'm thanking you for loving a grumpy old man like me. Well, I was speechless. I could hardly say, but I wasn't loving you. I was just doing my nurses a favor by getting you off their backs. Instead, I remained silent, but I long pondered what that man said to me. And although my motives had not been so pure, I nevertheless knew that I must have done something different that helped him feel connected. Because I hadn't really been intentional, I didn't really know what it was, but as I pondered it, I came to realize that he had left me three clues. The first clue was when he said, what is a woman like you doing eating lunch with a grumpy old man like me? Now, who has the power in a hospital? It's healthcare providers, right? Women like me, women like you, men like you. And I think just the simple act of sitting down empowers people. It equalizes the playing field, which is especially important with people who are sick and vulnerable. In fact, after this, I subsequently got a rolling chair to take with me on hospice consults when I saw patients throughout the hospital. What a difference it makes to sit down at eye level versus standing over, looking down at a patient in the bed. The second clue was when he called himself a grumpy old man. And for the first time, I didn't deny it. I didn't offer excuses or platitudes like, you're not a grumpy old man, you're just sick. You know, the truth was he was grumpy. He was driving people away with his grumpiness. By not denying it, he felt he was safe with me, that I was strong enough to handle his grumpiness without judgment. We didn't have to pretend that it wasn't there. And the third clue he provided was the value of touch. Old people, sick people, grumpy people do not get their fair share of touch. Touch connects. touch says more than a bunch of fancy words. And touch takes no extra time. That man, whose name I do not now remember, showed me what he needed and what I did not know. He was showing me how to abide with others. And not only was I learning about my verbal responses, I started to become more aware of my nonverbal responses, especially patting. I used to do a lot of patting, you know, there now, it'll be all right. But if you really look at it, patting can be off-putting, even condescending. I came to realize that I needed to stop patting and instead connect, give people strength. So rather than patting, I began giving them a firm, open hand on their shoulder, on their knee, on their back, not a pat. They need a hand that connects and strengthens. Same thing with hugs. Instead of hugging with pats, you know, you might do that for a sporting event or something, getting ready to go jogging. But when people are vulnerable, they need strength. And it's that enveloping type of hug. Well, by now I was in graduate school and I started actively studying PTSD. I learned about the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, and at that time it was the 3R version. I learned about helping people avoid triggers and to medicate them when triggers arose. I also learned something else, something I didn't like. I recognized my own judgmental attitude about people with PTSD. I'm embarrassed to tell you that for the first 10 years of my VA career, I harbored a prejudice toward veterans with PTSD. Although I provided the same care to them as everyone else, and I was always polite, I maintained an emotional distance. Each time I had to admit another veteran with PTSD to the hospital, I would think, why can't they get their act together? When I'd hear parts of their stories about their military experience, I'd think scornfully, you know, those are just excuses. The war has been over for years. They just need to get over it and move on with their lives. And I also thought these vets had brought their trouble on themselves. You know, they were often non-compliant. And when I muttered a disgusted, you know, I don't understand these guys, I was more honest than I knew. I didn't understand. But I wasn't going to bother trying either. But all of that was about to change. My time was in high demand. I walked fast and can dart up and down long hallways faster than a bullet from a high-powered military rifle. And I was at my usual breakneck speed when I decided to pop into a display of veterans' artwork at the medical center. I had surveyed about half of the displays when I was stopped in my tracks, struck by a painting of a soldier's face. Suddenly, I saw the suffering that that soldier saw. I imagined the people dying inside that burning hut. But more importantly, I saw how that soldier reacted to what he saw. I saw the tears of blood, the loss of vitality. And that's when my eyes were opened. More importantly, that's when my heart was opened. That painting was entitled Burning Vision, and it was burning my vision. Igniting smoldering veteran prejudices, searing the filters from my eyes. The painting touched me in a place I wasn't sure I wanted to be touched, shedding light on those ugly places of dark, judgmental attitudes about Vietnam vets. And in that protracted moment where time and my deeper self stood still, that painting spoke to me and changed me. Well, after that, I had a hard time going on with the rest of my day. I didn't know how to explain the change I had experienced. I mean, how do I describe going about my own business one minute and in an unguarded moment be healed of my prejudice? How do I explain that my carefully shielded from war world had just been shattered? How do I put into words how differently the world feels when arrogance and aloofness are replaced with understanding and connection? Well, I can tell you that that painting continued to haunt me. But I tell you this story because we all have prejudices. If we think we don't, that's the real problem, isn't it? Because we all have this brain that acts as a filter. And it's about bringing that filter out of the dark into the light so we can see how it is impacting our relationships. So as I said, that painting continued to haunt me. So I decided to track down the artist. His name was Tommy Bills. You see a picture of him there with me. And hesitantly, I called him. He lived over on the other side of the state in Fort Lauderdale. And I told him of my interest in his artwork. I even reluctantly told him about the effect his painting had on my prejudice. Well, Tommy assured me he was used to prejudice expressed toward people with PTSD. And he even mailed me the diary he had written as part of his recovery from PTSD. So now that my heart had been open, I was ready to listen. I could now bear witness to the suffering that he had experienced. So I read his diary very carefully. And like an old barnacled oyster shell pried open to reveal a luminous pearl, Tommy's journal exposed gems of understanding that are beyond the crusty, hardened surfaces. So prying open barnacled oyster shells to reveal those luminous pearls, you can see that it took many years to move my judgment toward veterans with PTSD to accepting that barnacled shell that often houses the trauma. There was just one problem. The DSM and the treatments for PTSD that I was learning about just didn't seem to work with my hospice patients. And there was a reason for this. My patients were dying. And dying is often a trigger for people with PTSD, especially if seeing others die or almost dying yourself was the source of their original trauma. But there's no way to avoid the death trigger when you're in hospice. Another problem was that the usual PTSD treatments were often not practical now. Patients couldn't participate in PTSD groups or learn some of the interventions because they were simply too weak. And further complicating the PTSD variable was this. For all of us, as we're dying, the conscious mind gets weaker and the unconscious mind gets stronger. And that's when memories often surface unbidden. So the situation we were facing was having memories surface unbidden because their own death was acting as a trigger. Their own mind was getting weaker, so their coping mechanisms weren't working anymore, and they could not participate in PTSD treatments. So I started to realize that it wasn't about trying to make the pain of the trigger go away. It was about how to let pain and peace sit side by side together without fear. The goal was to help dying people ground themselves so they could feel safe. And with dying people, this had to be something that was simple and quick. After much frustration of not being able to control the agitation of PTSD, we stumbled upon a very simple technique that evolved intuitively to help patients feel safe. We call it the anchoring heart technique. I noticed that as I sat quietly next to a restless patient's bedside, and I intuitively placed my hand firmly on their chest, that they seemed comforted. If they became agitated, I realized it might not be terminal restlessness. It might be PTSD. And so I would also tell them that they were safe. Then I started teaching family members how to use it with their loved ones. And that was great because family members always feel so helpless. They want to do something. And usually what they want to do is force food down them, right? So what I started doing was educating them on how their loved ones' needs were changing and that the body couldn't process food the way it used to. And so it often causes problems. And then I'd say, let me show you something that will really help. And I'd show them how to do the anchoring heart technique. And you can also use the anchoring heart technique with yourself. There are three steps. Maybe you can just do this with me for a moment. The first step is to simply anchor your hand, one or both, whatever's comfortable, firmly and tenderly on your heart, and breathe deeply. And the second step is to simply connect with what you are honestly feeling, whatever it is, even if it's just for a few seconds. Being mindful of what your body is feeling diminishes fear. And when fear decreases, peace increases. And the third step is to simply become curious about the place inside you that is not afraid of your feelings, even hurtful feelings. In other words, instead of numbing uncomfortable feelings, you want to develop the capacity to let peace and pain sit side by side together. And the way to do that is to ground yourself whenever fear of distressful sensations arise. And what you'll be doing is training the brain to have a different relationship with that fear-based amygdala part of your brain. So Opus Peace has a free video that teaches the anchoring heart technique. You can find it on our website or at this link. I would encourage you to use it, show it at your agency, show it with your patients, because it is simple, straightforward, and effective. Now, in my studies, I learned that people with PTSD need space. They tend to be on guard. They tend to be a bit suspicious and paranoid. So you don't want to corner them. I was told, you know, don't touch them. Well, that led me to believe, mistakenly, that they didn't need to be touched. But I was wrong. As I listened to them, I realized they needed touch just like everyone else does. It just needed to be done carefully. Make sure they see the touch coming. Not unexpected, or you're going to get that startle response. Cultivate a little bit of trust before you touch them. One thing they don't need is restraints. I'm going to have Marie, one of our Opus Peace founding nurses, tell you about a doctor who made the mistake of restraining a husband.
Marie? Yes, but your cat. Mm-hmm. Okay. This is a picture of my husband. Oh, hey, here I am. This is a picture of my husband, Jim. He's a Vietnam combat veteran. A few years ago, Jim needed cataract surgery. When they took Jim to the OR, they tucked both of his arms tightly under the blanket. Jim's anxiety escalated. Then they put a heavy band across his forehead to immobilize his head. He told them not so nicely to stop and let him get up. They tried to pacify him without any luck. He kept telling them he couldn't tolerate being restrained. Finally, they sedated him. When we went back for surgery to his other eye, Jim repeatedly told the doctor to make sure he was sedated or else he wasn't going to be operated on. The doctor did not acknowledge Jim. Jim said it more emphatically, and finally the doctor responded, "I heard you the first 5 times you said it, Mr. Bainbridge." That's when I spoke up. I told the doctor that he must have had other veterans besides Jim who had the surgery and that he needed to be aware of PTSD and how restraints could cause agitation for combat veterans. Sadly, I'm not sure if my message was received. The mistake this physician made was not listening to the patient and family.
So again, thinking in terms of, you know, we don't normally think in terms of post-operative cataract surgery and agitations being PTSD. What about flashbacks? Someone who has PTSD might actually start flashing back. And when this happened early in my career, I would argue with them about what they were seeing. As my practice matured, I not only learned not to argue with them, I learned to do whatever they needed to feel safe if it was an actual flashback. So if an agitated vet told me that there was Viet Cong under his bed, instead of telling him there were no Viet Cong under his bed, because even if that made him feel better in that moment, those Viet Cong came back after I left the room. So instead, we would put the mattress on the floor so that he didn't have to worry about there being anything, any Viet Cong anywhere where he couldn't see them. So sometimes you have to be a bit creative. You have to think outside the box. Again, as people are dying, as I said, the conscious mind gets weaker, the unconscious mind gets stronger, and the language of the unconscious is symbols and metaphors. So you have to use metaphorical language to connect with them. I mean, think about it. Each night, every night, your conscious mind goes to sleep and your unconscious mind becomes awake with dreams, images, metaphors. So, Marie, just tell him to go around. Okay. Images, metaphors. So when people, their conscious mind's getting weaker and their unconscious mind is getting stronger, we have to start speaking metaphorically. So let me give you an example. We had a World War II veteran who was admitted and we decided to put on an air mattress to his bed. So we got him up into a chair, unrolled the air mattress, and then someone said, "Okay, we can blow it up now." And what did that veteran in hospice do? He became agitated, yelling, "Where's the bomb? Where's the bomb?" And it took a long time to calm him down and convince him that he was safe. Now, if this would have happened just a few weeks before, while this veteran's conscious mind was more intact, this man would have recognized the context and not reacted with agitation. So at the end of life, you want to use metaphorical language to soothe patients with calming images, and you want to avoid threatening words and images. So you can see our team became very sensitive to how to manage PTSD when it emerged unbidden on people's deathbeds. But sometimes we were too sensitive. And I'll give you an example. One of my patients had been a World War II prisoner of war. And when we admitted him to our hospice unit, he became extremely agitated and combative with actual flashbacks of the POW camp and he kept climbing out of his bed to try to escape. The anchoring heart technique didn't calm him down. We treated him with high doses of sedatives, but that didn't work. We were providing one-on-one nursing care. Nothing helped. Now, though the patient had been urinating regularly, one of the nurses thought, maybe it's overflow urine. Let's check the bladder to see if it's emptying completely, because full bladders can cause agitation. Well, we did a bladder scan for residual urine, and it showed 4 times the normal amount of urine. We inserted a urinary catheter, and guess what? He immediately calmed down and returned from the POW camp. It was a graphic reminder to me that any noxious stimuli, like a full bladder, can trigger noxious combat memories. So yes, agitation at the end of life might be due to resurrected trauma memories, or it might be due to some of the regular biological causes. Is it ever a mistake to reinforce veteran identity? I used to think it was always important to reinforce a person's identity as a veteran. And it is, if the veteran minimizes their service, and they often do. But I remember the veteran who taught me differently. He corrected me when I was heaping praise on his veteran status. He said to me, "Look, you don't need to thank me for my service to this country. It was only 2 years. It happened 50 years ago. If you want to thank me for the 40 years I spent as a school teacher. That was sacrifice. And on some days, it was even heroic." On the other end of the spectrum are some veterans who only want to identify as a veteran and only want to associate with veterans. And I often mistakenly reinforced that. But at the end of life, I began to realize that this kind of one-dimensional identity didn't really bring them peace. I learned to help them explore other aspects of their identity. I'd say to them, "You are more than just a veteran. Tell me about who else you are." So I'm glad we're no longer ignoring veterans, and I'm glad we are having this conversation about the deleterious effects when we overemphasize their veteran status so that it overshadows other aspects of who they are. Forgiveness. It's a big issue in hospice, isn't it? And boy, did I have a big learning curve to navigate. First of all, just learning how much military regret surfaces at the end of life. I heard stories about the need to forgive. They had to forgive themselves if they had killed other people. I heard about guilt from not killing. I had more than a few say something to the effect of, "I couldn't do it. They had to pull me off the front lines." Guilt about not dying. I will tell you that survivor's guilt is huge. It is prevalent. And if they committed friendly fire, so to speak, in other words, killed one of their own, that's a different layer of guilt yet. They have to forgive the enemy. If they're a Vietnam vet, they have to forgive the government for using and betraying them. They have to forgive the world for being like it is with war in it. They have to forgive God for allowing the world to be like it is. And if they are unable to do this before they come to the end of their lives, then they arrive at the end of their lives filled with bitterness. And I will tell you that bitterness is a venom for the soul that greatly complicates peaceful dying. So when the term moral injury started appearing in the literature, I immediately grasped and appreciated the significance because I was seeing so much of it at the end of life. Now, when I first started hearing these kinds of stories, I would try to assuage their guilt or their shame. I'd say things like, well, you were just following orders. You were doing what you were trained to do. I probably would have done the same thing if I was in your situation. You know, you were in a kill or be killed situation. You know, but these didn't help. They didn't need my platitudes or rationalizations. They needed to do the work of forgiveness. And that's kind of a whole nother topic that we can talk about at another presentation sometime. What I will say is that we also saw a wound that was different than PTSD. We saw a wound that was more than moral injury. And some veterans called it a soul injury. And it took us years to figure out how they made that distinction. And it boiled down to this. Soul injury is a wound to your sense of self, your real self beyond the facade. So if PTSD separates you from your sense of self, then you not only have PTSD, but you also have a soul injury. If moral injury disconnects you from your own personhood, then you not only have a moral injury, you have a soul injury. And a soul injury stifles full potential because it separates a person from who they are meant to be. So part of the handouts that Catherine will get to you is this chart that will help you make the distinction between these three wounds of suffering. The approaches are different, and that's why it's important to distinguish between them. Now, before I leave the topic of forgiveness, and because I've been addressing mistakes, I want to include us as clinicians asking for forgiveness when we make a mistake, and also forgiving ourselves. So what I will tell you is that as long as you are sincere, veterans are very forgiving. I have found that when I make a mistake and I acknowledge it and I tell them I won't do it again, they not only forgive me, it actually helps them trust me. And remember, people with PTSD don't trust easily. So when I've gone too far or I asked the wrong question, I would simply say, I'm sorry I said that. I went too far. I wasn't respecting what you told me earlier when you said you didn't want to talk about that, or whatever it might be. Let me give you an example of how I sometimes push too hard. I went to a medical unit to do a consult, and the nurses told me that Emily, the patient's wife that I was going to see, wanted to be present when I met with her husband, Adam. I was also told that she did not want the word hospice used with Adam because she didn't want him to know that he was dying. Now, I deal with these kinds of situations all the time, and I have found that it's usually better for the patient to know. So I disregarded Emily's warning, ignoring the difference between usually and always. And I went in and I met with Adam alone without her. So now I'm at bedside and I initiated a discussion about his approaching death. Adam told me he was relieved to be able to talk about it. We had this great discussion and I left smugly patting myself on the back for proceeding without Emily's interference. Well, the next day, I go back to visit Adam and Emily together. I introduced myself, and Emily stiffened up, and she snapped at me, please leave right now, and don't come to talk to my husband again. Ah, there was no bridging the gap that I had created by disregarding her previous desire to protect her husband. Whatever benefit Adam had gotten from our discussion, it was undone by the pain that I caused his wife. Now, eventually, he did transfer to our hospice and palliative care unit, and he died. But I had to remain outside his circle of care. Well, a few months later, I saw Emily again. This time it was at the hospital's memorial service that we hold for the families of patients who die at our hospital. And she saw me too. And she glared at me from her fourth row seat in the auditorium. And when I took the microphone to welcome people to the service, I could feel her piercing gaze. And after a few opening remarks, I spoke about how we strive to serve and how we sometimes fail. I then looked at her and said, "Mrs. Schmidt, I know I made a mistake in not listening to your desires for your husband. I realize my action increased the suffering you were already feeling. I just want you to know that I'm very sorry for having done that to you." Well, she hesitated for a moment, and she'd had her arms crossed like this the whole time, but she nodded her head then and uncrossed her arms. We are not perfect. And if we wait to grow our practice until we can be perfect, then our practice will never grow into those brave spaces that we need to create in order to do what we do. So I encourage you to give yourself permission to make mistakes, take a risk, and I encourage you to recognize those mistakes, learn from them, and grow from them. Now you can see from the example that I just gave you about how we handle, I'm talking about all of us that work in hospice and palliative care, this time surrounding death, it's a very vulnerable time. And how we handle what we're doing with this patient's death or surrounding the trauma really impacts their bereavement care. So before I close, I want to address just a bit about respite and bereavement, because that care is also important. And respite care can be especially important for families of veterans with PTSD, because the PTSD can become exacerbated at the end of life, and that can really wear down the caregiver, especially if that person is elderly. So for myself, when I would offer respite services, not unusually, the caregiver would say, "Oh, he'd never go for that. No one can care for him the way I do." Well, again, earlier in my career, I would offer reassurance about the good care that we provide. But the mistake with that is it's kind of arrogant and irrelevant, isn't it? So instead, I started doing it differently. I would meet with both the caregiver and the veteran, and I would say this: "You know, we're not going to be able to care for you the way your wife does. We don't love you the way she does. We don't know all those little things you like the way she does. But you know as well as I do that she needs some rest and some time to replenish herself. This can be your gift to her, to accept the care from us and to do it without making her feel guilty. And we're pretty good listeners. You can tell us how you like things to be done and we'll do our best to accommodate your needs. Would you be willing to do that?" And I can tell you 9 times out of 10, that veteran would say yes. Now, I'd also negotiate with the wife about the quantity of her contact with us. You know, sometimes my assessment was that calling us each morning for a condition report would give her peace of mind. But more than a few times, I made the admission conditional that the caregiver would not call. I'd say, "You know, if you're only going to worry about him, if you're not going to focus on yourself, if you're only going to be beside yourself, then there's no point in admitting him because it won't provide you with any respite. You know, I'll call you every other morning. I'll call you if he needs you or if something changes. So if you'll agree to this, then I'll admit him. Otherwise, nothing's going to be accomplished and you'll be just as exhausted next week as you are right now." and bereavement care. I studied this book, Complicated Mourning by Therese Randall, and it really impacted the bereavement care that I provided. You know, bereavement care isn't always easy with stoic veterans. Good soldiers don't grieve. Grieving's a sign of weakness. So veterans often have a lot of complicated grief, and they would end up in my office. Now, in her book, Rando says that the source of complicated mourning is almost always the same. This is what she says. She says, underneath superficial appearances of acknowledgement, the mourner has not actually accepted the reality of the death, but harbors an unconscious feeling that it can somehow be reversed and that the deceased will return. There is some chance to undo it, and this causes unceasing searching. Now, I didn't really believe this when I first read it. Then I decided to put it to the test. And do you know what? Rando was right. Every veteran with complicated grief that came to me would tell me all the details of their loved one's death, and sometimes vivid details, even if it had happened years before. But when I really looked at what was causing that veteran to be stuck, it was that they were yearning for things to go back to the way it used to be. So my job was to help them move the grief that was in their head down to their heart so they could then release it and let it go. You know that saying, the 12-inch journey from the head to the heart is the longest journey you have to make. And that is so true with stoic veterans. So before we close today, one last thing. I know that many of you are going to be doing pinning ceremonies this week. And I'm going to ask Angie Snyder with Beata Home Health and Hospice to share with you a mistake that she made in doing honoring ceremonies at her agency. So see if you can relate to anything that she says. Angie?
Thanks, Deborah. So I was so excited when they rolled out the We Honor Veterans program at the NHPCO conference, and I couldn't wait to get back to my agency so that we could do a pinning for every veteran that we had on service. So I made sure that my team pinned every veteran at the bedside, and the way that we gave the pin, we called a ceremony. However, I know now that what we were doing was not a ceremony. We would simply say to the veteran, we have a pin for you to thank you for your service. And we would then don that pin on their t-shirt, and then we would quickly exit the home. There was no sharing of stories, no conversations, just a pin, maybe a certificate, and we were gone. So now fast forward to me having the opportunity to attend the very first Opus Peace Institute training, where I learned the importance of really capturing the story and the need for an actual pinning ceremony. So when I returned home from that training, I worked with my team to design a pinning ceremony that included addressing unfinished business from their military service. Now, my eye-opening moment was the first time a veteran shared a story about some guilt that he had been carrying for 60 plus years. And I witnessed such healing that day, and it reinforced for me the need to continue honoring veterans and helping them to release their unmourned loss and hurt and their unforgiven guilt and shame that they were carrying as a result of their military service.
Maybe we can all just take a moment to anchor our hearts, to think about all the burdens that these veterans are carrying, all the opportunities that we might have over this week and other weeks to come to be agents of healing for them. So thank you, Angie. And I know that the mistake that you made will not have been in vain, that your awareness changed your practice, and telling your story today will no doubt change other people's practice. So I'm just going to close with a short video. as we move into Veterans Day this week. So maybe we can, I'm sure many of you are watching in groups, and if some of you are veterans, many of you are, I'm sure, if you would be so good as to raise your hand so we can see that, if you're on gallery view, or if you're in a room of other people, if you might even stand. And the rest of us, if we can just anchor our heart, kind of just bow your head with these veterans who are online with us right now, and in whatever way you might want, just honor them. Thank you. Catherine?
Hi, everyone. Just want to thank Deborah again for another incredible webinar. I know this spoke to me as it did to many of you, I'm sure, and hope that you're able to put this into practice, not only this week, but as you continue to serve veterans going forward. We did enter the links to the resources that Deborah mentioned, that comparison chart, as well as the dedicated Opus Peace page on the We Honor Veterans website. And again, we will be sharing the recording of this webinar both on the We Honor Veterans website and on the Opus Peace website as well. I did want to mention that again, next week, we will be having another webinar on screening and referrals of veterans with PTSD and moral injury. I'm putting the registration link in the chat box right now. I also know that Opus Peace has a lot of activities coming up, that they have ongoing trainings. So please be sure to head to their website for more information on those. Or if you have any questions about their events or resources, you are also welcome to reach out to the Honor Veterans team and we'll be happy to point you in the right direction. But thank you everyone for being here, for showing up and for listening. We wish you a wonderful week. And again, thank you so much to Deborah and the entire Opus Peace team. It is always a treasure to have you. Thank you. Mm-hmm.